Good afternoon and welcome again to this second day of the virtual training on the SDG 241. We have seen yesterday with Aspandyar the theory behind the SDG indicator 241. We have gone through the 11 themes, and we have seen also the expectation of the SDG 241 indicator. So today, as already mentioned, we will have a more practical day today and tomorrow. So we will have exercises and we will see the analysis of your data with Steda. So today, our main presenter will be Gianluigi Nico. So I will leave him to introduce himself. And let me now give the floor to Aspandyar if he wants to say something like doing a better summary of today, of yesterday subjects. So Aspandyar, I leave the floor to you.
Stefania, thank you very much and a good day to everyone. So now you summarized yesterday's proceedings very well. So we covered the methodological and conceptual aspects of SDG 241 as to how the framework look like, what are the dimensions, what are the themes and the sub-indicators that are covered, what are the data collection tools, as well as the periodicity of data collection and reporting, and as well as the modality of reporting the indicator. And we there discussed the dashboard approach as well as the aggregate indicator. We also discussed the process that FAO adopted to develop the methodology of SDG 241, and we highlighted the contributions and collaborations with BBS throughout this process. In terms of discussions around the methodology, as well as testing the indicator at different stages. So with this brief context, I mean, I will immediately give the floor to Gianluigi for him to, as Stefania mentioned, introduce himself first, and then walk us through the tool that has been created to analyze Bangladesh pilot tests. So Gianluigi, the floor is yours now.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I hope you can hear me okay.
Yes.
Okay, that's great. It's a pleasure to be here, of course. My name is Gianluigi Nico. I am an empirical economist by education. And I have supported, let's say, the technical part of the SDG indicator 2.4.1 with Aspandyar and Stefania. Now, concerning today and the next sessions of this training, we will be focusing a little bit on the, let's say, the technical part and the computation of the 11 sub-indicators that are attached to the main SDG indicator 2.4.1. In this regard, the way I see the structure of these sessions is to give a brief overview in the next 30 minutes about all the tools that FAO has developed in order to collect, analyze and organize the data, including the reporting and the sampling strategy that is to be implemented before field operations. Whereas in sessions 2 and 3, we will be playing a little bit with the data collected a couple of years ago in Bangladesh using the pilot survey, containing approximately 420 agricultural holdings, and we will construct the 11 sub-indicators. This will be done by giving before an overview of the rationale and the measurement of each of the 11 sub-indicators related to SDG 2.4.1, and then we will look at the practical implementation and computation of the variables that are needed in order to get our final sub-indicator. In the sessions tomorrow, we will continue to explore the last dimension related to the SDG indicator 2.4.1, which is the social dimension. I guess we won't have time to do it today, but we will have time tomorrow. And then we will present the final dashboard approach according to this traffic light approach that has been explained and explored yesterday by Aspandiar and Stefania. So I would say I can start sharing my screen. And then depending very much on how Stefania and Aspandiar would like to conduct this session, we can either save some time at the end of the presentation for question and answer, or we can make it more interactive. We can decide in due course of the presentation. So I will start sharing my screen. And okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. During session one of today, we will look at the process that goes from the sampling strategy to the data analysis. So especially, we will be looking at the all the tools that have been developed by FAO in order to make this process successful. In this regard, I envisage three main objectives. The first objective is, of course, to give an overview about the sampling strategy and the related document that has been developed that specifically applies to SDG indicator 2.4.1. Then we will briefly look at the structure of the survey module that has been developed by FAO in order to collect all the relevant information that we need in order to compute the 11 sub-indicator. And finally, we will look at the template that has been developed for data entry operations right after data have been collected. The data must be entered in an Excel spreadsheet in case we go for face-to-face interview. Then we need to organize the data. And finally, we need to analyze the data and report about the sustainability status of agricultural area. So starting from the sampling strategy, I have added some hyperlink to the presentation that you can easily click just to explore more in detail the content of the sampling strategy. But before doing it, I would like to remember that what we are going to measure is the proportion of agricultural area which is under productive and sustainable agriculture. So this is the main goal of the SDG indicator 2.4.1, which means that what we need to sample our agricultural holdings, and then we want to measure the sustainability status associated to areas of agricultural holdings that have been sampled during the implementation of the sampling strategy itself. Therefore, the observational units and the target population are by nature, by definition, agricultural holdings in the country of interest. And when we talk about agricultural holding, of course, we do not only refer to agricultural holding in the household sector, but also to agricultural holding in the non-household sector. Agricultural holding can be defined somehow as economic units of agricultural production. And of course, when we think about agriculture, we, in a broad sense, we make reference to the primary sector, net of mining and quarry, which is crop, livestock, forestry, fishery, and aquaculture. In this case, in this specific case, however, and this is important to highlight, we are only considering agricultural holding that engage in the production of crop and livestock and mixed crop and livestock activities. So we are not really considering the agricultural sector related to forestry, fishery, and aquaculture. This is out of the scope of the SDG 2.4.1. When we talk about the household sector and the non-household sector, the FAO World Food Programme, World Food Programme for the Census of Agriculture 2020 has developed a clear definition of the household and non-household sector. Of course, this must be adapted to the country specificities, but in general terms, the household, the agricultural holding in household sector can be defined as agricultural holding that are run by household or by family members, by a combination of household members, one or more household members. Whereas the non-household sector, again, in a broad sense, can be defined as agricultural holding that are run by corporation or government institutions. Again, there is a link to the FAO World Programme for the Census of Agriculture that you can explore and look more in detail at the definition. This being said, of course, it implies that the sampling unit, what we need to sample are agricultural holdings, whereas the sampling frame must be the complete list of all agricultural holdings in a given country. This means that the complete list of agricultural holding can typically be developed to the agricultural census. The agricultural census, I would say that is the key instrument in order to have the list of agricultural holding from which you will be sampling some for your survey, for the implementation of the survey, the agricultural survey or the survey module developed by FAO. However, there is also perhaps more cost-effective approach, which is based on the integration of some screening question to a population census in order to arrive the final list of agricultural holdings in your country. Now, the reason why this can be a cost-effective approach is because as you know, I mean, agricultural population censuses are conducted once every 5 or 10 years. They are pretty expensive. And therefore, in case you envisage to conduct a population census, you may think about adding some screening question in order to have the complete list of all agricultural holdings in your country. Having defined the observational units, the target population, the sampling unit, and the sampling frame, the next stage, the next phase is to have a suitable sampling design. For the specific case of the SDG indicator 2.4.1, a two-stage stratified sampling design is typically a suitable sampling design in order to collect the variables that we need for constructing our indicator. In the case of a two-stage stratified sampling design, the primary sampling unit, of course, are enumeration areas, counties, or villages. And the idea is to have a proper stratification of this primary sampling unit, ideally by agroecological zone in the countries. For example, you may have a stratification proportional to agroecological zone that exhibit the same climatic conditions. Once we have stratified our primary sampling unit and we have selected randomly our primary sampling unit, of course, we need to select within this primary sampling unit agricultural holdings. And again, given the complexity behind the SDG indicators, it is advisable, strongly advisable, to stratify the secondary sampling unit by, for example, economic typologies of the holding or whether or not the holding irrigate or do not irrigate the land. Economic typologies, again, since we are interested in agricultural holding that carry out crop, livestock, and mixed crop and livestock activities, a typical stratification can be done proportionally to the agricultural holding that engage in any of these type of economic activities. And finally, the reporting units, having also designed our sample, the reporting units is gonna be any representative of the holding Of course, ideally, for example, in the case of agricultural holding in the household sector, the ideal reporting unit, which is the person who is going to respond to our questions, is like the head of the agricultural holding, the holder, or the co-holder of the agricultural holding. The most informed person, typically, is the one that can minimize data entry mistakes and to have a suitable reporting of the SDG indicator 2.4.1. The second instrument or tool that FAO has developed is the survey module. The survey module is, okay, this is a very flexible survey, very short, very cost effective, I would say, because it contains basically a bare minimum question that can be administered either as a standalone survey or can be attached to an agricultural survey in case your country has already envisaged to conduct an agricultural survey, or you can simply integrate in your agricultural survey some of the questions that are within the survey module. So the idea is that if in the agricultural survey, most of the information that you need in order to compute the 11 sub-indicators are already available, you can simply integrate the remaining questions in order to have the full list of variables that are going to be used for the calculation of the 11 sub-indicators. Again, this was already mentioned yesterday, so I won't be spending much time on this, but we have 11 themes and 11 corresponding sub-indicators. Each sub-indicator consists of some key questions and the related collected information is then converted into a quantitative information that is used for the construction of the indicator. Finally, FAO, and this is a supporting document, has developed an enumerator manual. Again, here is a link. You just wanna show you the enumerator manual, where you basically have, for each question, you have a clear explanation of the meaning and the term behind each question, including the reference period, whether it is the last calendar year, the last 3 years, and so on and so forth. The structure of the survey module, now I'm going back to the survey module before presenting a little bit more in detail the enumerator manual. The survey module is comprised of the main section that have been structured in a logical order in order to gather the information that we need. Therefore, we have section one and section two, where we collect the key information about the sex of the respondent, his or her role within the agricultural holding. And then in section two, we are gonna collect the area of the agricultural holding. Section A, B, and C, they have been structured in such a logical order in order to collect all the information that we need to construct the indicators that are attached to each dimension of the SDG indicator 2.4.1. In a few instances, you will need to combine some of the information in section A and section A and section C in order to get an indicator that is, for example, in the social dimension. But this has been done in order to avoid repeating the same question in each section. And as I was saying before, data, the unit of observation is the agricultural holding, even though, and again, this is something that I highlight, we are interested in the corresponding agricultural area. So the unit of observation is really the agricultural holding and the holder or the co-holder or any person who is going to represent the agricultural holding. About the enumerator manual, the enumerator manual provides a detailed description of the survey module and review the standard operating procedure for each question. I would say that the overarching goal of the enumerator manual is to ensure there is a common understanding between respondent on one side and enumerators and supervisor on the other side about the definition and terms behind each question. For example, you see here, I'm gonna zoom in, you see here that this is apparently a very simple question where we are gonna ask about the type of holding, whether it is in the household or in the non-household sector. The enumerator manual will further illuminate about the meaning of the household and the non-household sector. That's why there is a box where you can, when you have many references, you can link to look at the proper definition of the household and non-household sector, which in which a specific case must be adapted to the country-specific context. But again, you will have a general overview. And then you will have example of commonly encountered instances where questions and responses might not be easy to administer and record. So there are questions that they can have a different interpretation. And this is also the logic behind the cognitive tests that have been conducted. And therefore, I mean, we want to make sure that each question is fully understood by both respondents and the numerator. And this minimizes, of course, the mistakes during data collection operations. And finally, there are there is a sort of guidance on how to use a skip question and filter question. For example, if you say no to a given question, you will be asked to skip the next question and go to another question. So this is critically important in order to have a logical process about the data collection through the survey model. The other tool that FAO has developed is related to, I mean, aims at collecting, entering the data once they have been collected from the field. In this regard, we need to imagine a situation where data have been collected in the field through face-to-face interviews. So each information has been filled in the questionnaire, and we need to report in a dedicated template developed by FAO where you need to store all the information. Okay, here I added an hyperlink, which is directly linked to my desktop, but you can easily access because I shared the folder today. So this is the typical template for data entry operation. So imagine that I had to hide some of the information which are confidential, but here you imagine that you have a template which is completely empty and you need to enter the information collected through the survey questionnaire. In order to facilitate data entry operation, you have a corresponding codebook. So for each question and each variable, you have the specific code and the specific label. For example, question 101041, which asks about the sex of the respondent, the associated code can be 1 or 2, and then you need to know that 1 stands for male and 2 stands for female. The same applies to question 101051, which asks about the role of the person within the agricultural holding. So you have different code from 1 to 5. So you have this categorical variable, and for each the corresponding label, which can be the holder, the co-holder, the manager, and so on and so forth. So back to our presentation. There are a few general rules that should be, let's say, followed during a data entry operation, which is when to start entering data collected, and of course it's better to do it as soon as possible, because these of course will help minimize delays and of course maximize the opportunities for checking, rechecking, and validating the data. confidentiality. It's important that, of course, the data are confidential. So it's better to avoid the people outside the team can consult the data collected through the survey module. And finally, I wanna, let's say, devote the last slide to introduce what is gonna be the next session. So the process so far has a little bit explored all the process that goes from the sampling design to data collection, data entry operation and organization, and what is still to be done, of course, is the analysis of data. Now, since we have organized our data in appropriate output form, which is ideally an Excel spreadsheet, we need to start to select our variables, the variables that are needed in order to construct the indicators, and to transform this variable into primary variable that will be further used to construct the final sub-indicator. So the idea I have added this diagram here is that we want to use the qualitative information collected through the survey, which is collected through asking a specific question. And we want to compute the primary variable. I have added an example about the farm output value. The farm output value, of course, we need two primary variables, which are price and quantities. And we need to multiply price and quantities in order to construct the farm output value. And then we will construct an additional variable, which is the land area, in order to collect, to construct the very first sub-indicator, which is the farm output value per hectare, which will be further assessed against the sustainability criteria that will be explored in few minutes. So I would say that I can stop here since it's 10:30 and it was envisaged 30 minutes for this presentation before moving to the next sessions. And so I don't know, depending on Stefan and Asfan, if you want to answer some questions in case.
Okay, thank you very much, Luigi. It was a very nice presentation. So for the moment, it seems we don't have any question, but let's wait a couple of minutes. In the meantime, let me just remind all the participants that I have promoted everyone as panelists. So please ensure that you are always muted, and because you are able to unmute yourself alone. So just raise the hand if you have any question or write in the chat box if you want to talk or if you want to have any comment or whatever. So it seems we don't have any question, Gianluigi. So I think we can move with your next session on constructing the sub-indicator in the economic dimension, if I'm not wrong. And for sure, I'm sure that questions will come. Okay. So I give the floor again to you.
Okay, thank you very much, Stefania. I'm gonna share my screen again. And okay, we have 50 minutes just to, you know, to make my time efficient. We have 50 minutes, right, for this session. Okay, I guess so.
Yes, you have 50 minutes and then we break.
Okay, perfect. So I will try to stop like I don't know a few minutes before in order to answer questions in case, or if you have questions during the presentation, I'm happy to answer. Okay, in the next 50 minutes I will be presenting the construction of the sub-indicator in the economic dimension, and as I was anticipating before, these three sub-indicators have been constructed using data from the a pilot survey conducted in Bangladesh a couple of years ago. Okay, we have three main sub-indicators related to the economic dimension. The first sub-indicator is the farm output value per hectare. So we want to know the value from agricultural production, crop and livestock per hectare of land, the net farm income, and finally, the very indicator is about the risk mitigation mechanism. Okay, the rationale behind the very first sub-indicator is basically a measure of the agricultural area which is associated with farm whose output value per hectare fulfill the following criteria. Therefore, we're gonna, let's say, assign a sustainability status which is desirable to agricultural holding whose farm output value per hectare is greater than two-thirds, is at least two-thirds of the corresponding 19th percentile. The sustainability status starts to be acceptable for holding whose farm output value per hectare is between is greater than one-third of the 19th percentile, but is lower than two-thirds of the corresponding 19th percentile. And finally, agriculture holding, the area associated to agricultural holding is unsustainable in case of holding whose productivity value is lower than one-third of the 19th percentile. So there are a few calculations that has to be done regarding this indicator. This is perhaps one of the most complex, but also one of the most interesting indicators that we have in our among all indicators. The first variable that we need to compute, there are three main variables, I would say, that we need to compute in order to calculate the sustainability status of agricultural area associated with the productivity of agricultural holding. These are the price, the quantity, and finally, the agricultural area itself. The farm output value, which is our numerator, can be calculated as the summation of the quantity of a given crop related to a given agricultural holding, crop or byproduct or livestock or its related byproduct livestock and also on farm commodities of a given agricultural holding, which must be multiplied by the corresponding farm gate price. The agricultural area, land area, instead, is calculated by adding up all the area that I have listed here, which are temporary crops outdoors or under low shelter, under greenhouses, and so on and so forth. So these are the three main variables that we need to calculate. I'm going to introduce it and then I will show you the practical implementation calculation for this indicator. Where can the information in the survey? Concerning price and quantity, in the survey module, there is a very clear section where you can have all the information that you have about the quantity and price of each crop, of each crop byproduct, of each livestock, and of each livestock byproduct. You see here that we have collected information about the quantity produced of a given crop and the corresponding unit of measurement, which must be, well, in this case, it's not really important, but in theory, this should be converted into a standard unit of measurement in case you use no standard unit of measurement. But again, let's forget about it because this is not important. In the end, we are multiplying by the farm gate price here. And we get the total value of production of each crop byproduct, and the same applies to livestock and livestock byproduct. So this is the first two variables that we need to compute, and we can find it in the economic section, in section A, which is the economic dimension of the order. Which is, yeah, this is very well structured, I would say, because it's easy to find the information that we need. Secondly, we need to calculate the agricultural area of the holding. And this is easily calculated by looking at the information in section two, and particularly in question 2.2, where you see that you have the total agricultural area of the holding. Here it is important to convert the unit of measurement in hectares. So in case data about the land area of temporary crops, etc., is collected in either a non-standard unit of measurement or in a standard unit of measurement, which is not hectares. We need to convert this data in hectare, because in the end, what we want is the value of production per hectare of land. So these are the two questions that we have and that we need to transform into quantitative variable. Okay, the key indicator, therefore, is finally calculated. Once we have the price, the quantity, and the agricultural land area, we need to divide the farm output value, price times quantity, by the corresponding agricultural land area. And we get our key indicator, which is the farm output value per hectare. Now, there is a very important step that has to be implemented, which is the breakdown by 12 categories of farm. Now, we saw before that we are basically collecting data about agricultural holding that engage both in the agricultural, in the household sector, and in the non-household sector, and agricultural holding that engage both in crop, livestock, or mixed agricultural activities of livestock and crop type. Plus, we are collecting data about agricultural holding that irrigate their land and agricultural holding that do not irrigate their land. So you see that these are very much, you know, different from one another. And of course, comparing the farm output value per hectare of a given category of agricultural holding with another category makes little sense, because we may end up with some categories of agricultural holding very having a very low value of production per hectare, perhaps because of their dimension, because they are part of the household sector, etc., and other agricultural holding with very high value of production per hectare. And this is not what we want, because we want to have a sustainability status by agricultural holding that belong to the same categories, category of farm. This is the rationale behind the disaggregation, the breakdown by 12 categories of farm. And I will show you in a second how to calculate the relative threshold for each category. Now, the idea is to derive the sustainability status based on the threshold that we explained before. So if the value of production per hectare is higher than 2/3 of the 19th percentile, in that case, the land area associated with the agricultural holding is gonna be green or desirable, or in case it is not, could be either yellow, which is acceptable, or unsustainable, which is red. How to do it? Okay, we need to calculate some threshold, and this threshold must be specific to the category of agricultural holding. So all agricultural holding belonging a given category will have a given threshold. In order to calculate the threshold, here you see the distribution of the farm output value per hectare, which is our key indicator that we have constructed before, that goes from 0 to 3 million local currency unit. You see that this is a very right skewed, though there are very few agricultural holding having a value which is very high, whereas the highest probability to have a given value is around, yeah, I would say 300,000 local currency unit. Now, given this distribution, we need to know what is the value associated to the 19th percentile, which is this one. I have tried to highlight it here, which is approximately 864,000 local currency unit. This is our threshold. I mean, this is not the threshold. This is the value of the 19th percentile. And now we can construct the threshold. We say that the threshold for the desirable status must be greater or equal to 2/3 of this value, in which case the land area of the agricultural holding is gonna be desirable. If it is comprised between, if it is greater than 1/3, but lower than 2/3 of the 19th percentile, it's yellow, otherwise it's gonna be red. Now, given this distribution, I'll show you the final output. The final output is basically this one. Okay, you see here, you have different categories of farm. You have farm which engage in agricultural production of crop type in the outdoor sector and then irrigate their land. And then you have mixed agricultural activities in the outdoor sector and that they irrigate their land and so on and so forth. The percentile that is stable across the same category, but varies across across different types of holding, is the first value that we need to calculate. And this value corresponds to this one. So this is an example based on agricultural holding that engage in crop production in the outdoor sector and that they irrigate their land. The 1/3 of the 19th percentile is approximately 285,000 local currency unit. Whereas 2/3 of the 19th percentile is 570,000 local currency unit, approximately. So these are, let's say, the lower bound threshold, and this is the upper bound threshold. Okay, let's take the example of the first agricultural holding, whose farm output value per hectare is approximately 387 thousand local currency unit. This value is exactly in between the lower and upper bound. And that's the reason why the agricultural area, which is this one, of this farm, can be considered as acceptable. So in our distribution, we will have its value, which is around, which is in between the red line and the green line. That's why it's yellow or acceptable. This is translated in acceptable. Another very quick example. Let's take like, agricultural holding whose land area is not sustainable, which is this one. You see that the farm output value related to this agricultural holding, which is agricultural holding number 6, is 241,000 local currency unit. The thresholds are the same because we are talking about the same farm category. This is lower than 2/3 of the 19th percentile, in which case the sustainability status is red or non or unsustainable. So that's the rationale behind the indicator. Now, before moving to the next indicator, I'm gonna show you, and perhaps, I don't know if we have enough time, perhaps Asfandiera and Stefania can advise on this, but we can work together in parallel to make it a little bit more interactive. I shared a folder. You can simply copy paste your folder in your desktop if you want to work in parallel for the calculation of this indicator. This is the indicator number one, the sub indicator number one, farm output value per hectare. The only thing that you need to do in this case is to change your computer name and, of course, the path where you have saved the folder. So basically, you need to change this one and the computer name. Yeah, this is my computer name, and you simply change it. In any case, I go ahead for, of course, because otherwise I run out of time, but let's look at the practical implementation of this indicator. So again, here I summarized the three sustainability criteria. The first thing that I'm gonna do is to upload the data set, which are the data set containing information on the land area and so on. The second step is to calculate the 12 categories of agricultural holding. And in order to do it, we need the information on whether or not the agricultural holding, which is this one, belong to the household sector or the non-household sector. And this is the corresponding variable. I'm sorry, it's... Okay. And I'm gonna attach a label. So you will see that I have basically a distribution of agricultural holding by agricultural holding belonging to the household sector, which are more than 2/3, and a bit more than 50% belong to the non-household sector. Okay, let's go ahead, because then we need to know the main holding activity, whether they engage in crop production, livestock, or mixed activity. And I'm gonna calculate this variable, taking the information from question A1000. You will have three code. Code one stands for crop two, code two stands for livestock, and three for mixed activity. The third variable that I need to construct is whether the land is irrigated or not. And finally, I can have our 12 categories of agricultural holding. I'm gonna attach a label just to make it more clear. And if I tabulate this variable, which is the last variable I calculated, you will see, I don't know if you can see from my screen, but basically you will see that you have the 12 categories of agricultural holding. So the vast majority belong to the household sector, they engage in crop production, and they irrigate the land, which correspond to 1/3 of total agricultural holding in the country. Yeah, of course, this is a pilot, but again, let's assume that it is representative of the country. And then you will have the distribution for the other typologies of agricultural holding. Okay, I'm gonna save this portion of the data set that will be used at a later stage. And what I'm gonna do is to calculate the agricultural area of the holding. So the agricultural area of the holding is basically given by this question, which is the total area of land within associated to a given area. Now, the problem that we have is that we might have, this is not the case because everything has been collected in acres, but we might have a different unit of measurement and they must be properly converted. Now, we know that 1 acre of land, correspond to approximately 0.4 hectare of land. So we need to convert by simply multiplying. Then we might potentially have a land area which have been collected in square meter. Therefore, we need to divide by the corresponding conversion factor and so on and so forth. Okay, this has done. So far we have the agricultural area, we have the type of holding, the categories of farm, and now we need to construct the value added, which is the sum of the quantity times the farm gate price. I'm gonna upload the data set of interest based on the structure of the survey module, and then I'm gonna compute the value of the value added from crop production. So this is the value added from crop, this is the value added from livestock, and this is from other on-farm activity. And finally, I'm gonna calculate the overall value of production. I'm gonna keep only the relevant variable and I'm gonna save my data set. This is the final indicator, okay? The final indicator use information on the categories of farms, the 12 categories of farm, the agricultural value of production, and the agricultural area. These are the three information that we need. I have done some outlier detection because, since we are human, it might be that during data collection, some records have not been properly reported in the questionnaire, or perhaps during data entry operation, you might record a value which is in reality an outlier. Therefore, outlier detection basically will inform about the value that lie above the distribution of a given variable. And for example, if you are gonna, you see that you have some value which are very high here. This is a very high value, and whereas the vast majority of value, basically they lie around zero. Therefore, what I have done was to look at the distribution of the agricultural area of each group, and then I have detected the outlier and replaced the outlier with the median value. Again, we should be spending like one entire session about this, but we can discuss at a later stage, but so far I will implement automatically this code, but absolutely I'm happy to respond to your question about outlier detection. Okay, once we have cleaned up our data, we have constructed our farm output value per hectare, which is the value of production divided by the agricultural area, we need to construct, we need to assign a sustainability status to each agricultural holding and to the corresponding agricultural area. For example, four agricultural holdings that are part of the first farm category, which are crop in the household sector and that they irrigate the land. What I'm gonna do is to look at the value of the 19th percentile, which is this one. And then what I do is to calculate a variable which is equal to the value of the 19th percentile. And then I say, your sustainability status is green if the value of production is greater than 2/3 or 0.66. of the 19th percentile, and you belong to the very first farm category. It's yellow. I have given the code number 2 for yellow. If your farm output value is greater than 1/3 of the 19th percentile, and at the same time is lower than 2/3 of the 19th percentile, and again, you belong to the very first farm category. The same applies to the third sustainability status, which is unsustainable or red, in case your farm output value per hectare is lower than 1/3 of the 19th percentile. Now, if I run this part of the code, okay, I have finally calculated the very first sub-indicator. I'm gonna keep only the relevant variable, and I'm gonna show you how the data set looks like. The data set here, you will have the agricultural area of the holding for the first holding, which is holding number 026, and the corresponding sustainability status, which is desirable. Then you have the other sustainability status that can be acceptable, non-sustainable, and so on and so forth. So that's the rationale behind the first indicator, and I will stop here. And I will go back to my presentation. And I will move to the second sub-indicator. I hope I was enough clear while explaining, but again.
Maybe Gianluigi, before moving to the next sub-indicator, let's see if we have any question on this one. Sorry, Aswandyar, you wanted to say something.
Exactly, I was highlighting the same point. So Gianluigi, don't worry about the time. We can reshuffle the sessions and make some shorter, but this is the part which is very important. So let's take some questions, if participants have any. Yeah.
Perfect, thank you very much. Yeah, that's much appreciated. Okay. The second sub-indicator is related to the net farm income. Again, this is in principle a very complex indicator, but if you decide to use the information from the survey module, you will make your life much easier. Because as you know, the net farm income is basically calculated as the difference between the value of production and all the cost that you have. And therefore, let's start by highlighting the criteria and then we will move to the specific formula. The idea behind this sub-indicator is to know about the proportion of agricultural areas that are economically viable or profitable. And this profitability is classified based on three criteria. Therefore, these are the agricultural area of a given holding is desirable in case the profits are above zero over the past three consecutive years prior to the date of the interview or the survey implementation is yellow if the profit have been above zero for at least one of the past three consecutive years. And finally, in case for all the past three consecutive years, the profit were below zero, the sustainability status is red or unsustainable. Now, the profit are calculated according to this formula, where the net farm income is basically given by the total farm cash receipt, including direct program payments, income in kind, total operating expenses, including the cost of labor, the labor cost, depreciation, and the value of inventory change. This is the main formula, which is pretty much complex, I would say. Therefore, you need a lot of information in order to get it. However, if you decide to rely on the survey module, there is a specific question about the profitability of the agricultural holding, which is this one, question 8.7, where enumerators will ask to the respondent how often the holding was profitable over the last three calendar year. And you see here the reference given. And then you have a number of options. So they could be unprofitable for all 3 years, profitable in one of the 3 years, profitable in two out of the 3 years, and so on. And the idea is that based on the answer that will be given by the respondent to the enumerator, you can easily assess the sustainability status of the holding under this sub-indicator. In which case, so let's imagine that the respondent reported that it was profitable in two out of the 3 years, the sustainability status will be acceptable. Desirable, which is the vast majority of cases, as you see in this table, in case for all three consecutive years, the agricultural holding was profitable. Okay, the implementation of this indicator is, in principle, would be very complex, but in practice is very short and straightforward, I would say. What we need is, of course, to upload the portion of the data set with the information about the profitability of the agricultural holding over the past 3 years, which is this question, holding profitability over the past three calendar years. So it's question A15. And then you simply are gonna give a code depending on the response, on the answer given. So if you look at the answer, you will get unprofitable for all 3 years. You see here, there is a data entry mistake in reality. So there is an assumption made that zero in reality is one. This is the way I recoded. Unprofitable for all 3 years, which is 9% of the total distribution, of the total holding, profitable in 1 out of the 3 years, and so on and so forth. Depending on the answer given, you can construct your indicator. You will attach the label just to, you know, to have a reference behind each code, or a label behind each code. You keep only the relevant variable and you save the final data set. The final data set will look like this one. And of course, then we will attach, we will merge the corresponding agricultural area here, which is what we are interested in, as we did for the farm output value per hectare. This will be done during the reporting process when we are gonna display the dashboard, the final dashboard. So this indicator was rather easy to calculate despite the complexity behind the agricultural income. Moving forward, okay, the third sub-indicator related to the economic dimension measures the access to or use of one of the following risk mitigation mechanism by the agricultural holding. So the rationale is basically to know whether in case of potential...
Excuse me, Gianluigi. Let's just take, you know, a very short break for questions. If sure, there are sure. any, and then so you know the floor is open now to the participants if they have any questions regarding the two sub indicators that have been covered, you know, during this session, farm output value per hectare and net farm income. So if there are any questions, please feel free to ask. If there is any question, the participants can unmute themselves and ask the question.
Even if any of you have any comment, please feel free to intervene. Okay, please, Amirul, you have the floor.
Oh, yeah, just I was following this, you know, slides. Very interesting using Stata, and then have you shared this, you know, Stata do commands with the participants and the data for collected for 2.4.1 so that they can try on their own? Do you get my point?
Yeah, absolutely. Sorry, I was muted. That's a little more. We basically shared this morning the folder containing all the data scripts plus the data that were collected by BBS Bangladesh. Therefore, as I was saying before, the material should be in there. And if you envisage to collect these data for this indicator in the future, you only need to adapt a little bit the status streets, but in theory, and of course, we're happy to collaborate together. But of course, there are the scripts and the presentation should help in calculating the indicator. There are a few adjustments that must be done. My suggestion would be to not apply the status script automatically, but to also take a look at each variable to make sure everything is done properly. But the basis is in there. And this has been shared by Stefania, I guess, this morning.
I see one email with the attachment, but I didn't go into that one. But, you know, I will request the participants, you know, after today's session, if they try at home, if there's any problem, you know, arises, we can, you know, discuss, you know, tomorrow.
Yeah, sure. Sure.
Okay.
So and I would just like to add to this, Amirul and Gianluigi, that this status script and routines are available on SDG241 webpage as well. Plus, you know, this has been shared with BBS already as part of the pilot exercise a couple of years back. So basically, once we developed these scripts, these were duly shared with the BBS colleagues for them to have it and then basically use it for the next round of data collection. But in any case, I mean, it has been shared this morning as well. So yeah, this is a very good point. If the participants want to practice with some changes, of course, then you know, they can, and if they find any difficulties or issues, they can always get back to us.
Yeah. And again, you know, after this training, when the real data will be available with them, when they will start using those data to create these indicators, at the point, if some problem arises, we can also arrange some discussion with you so that and everything is clarified at the stage. Is it okay?
For sure, no problem.
Okay, in that case, we can proceed, and then participants will, you know, take all the documents with them and try to follow the, you know, instructions given by you know, Nico. Okay, carry on then. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Amirul. Okay, Aswandar, we don't have any question. Anyway, participants, you can, of course, ask the question anytime in the chat box, and then we will ask Gianluigi the questions at the end of the next sub-indicator. So, Gianluigi, you have the floor again.
Okay, thank you, Stefania. So the next sub-indicator is about risk mitigation mechanism, and the idea behind this indicator is to know whether in case of...
Gianluigi, maybe you want to share the screen again.
Sorry.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
No problem.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and the idea behind this indicator is basically to measure the proportion of agricultural area of a given holding that can be exposed to extreme weather condition, climatic condition, or external shocks, and whether they have mitigation mechanism to cope with these shocks. So there are three main risk mitigation mechanisms that have been identified, which is the first one is access to or availed credit, access to or availed insurance, and on-farm diversification, which implies that the value of production of a single agricultural commodity is greater than two-thirds of the total value of production of the holding. So if you're gonna like to diversify your production, you will likely face you can better cope with external shocks. If at least two of these mechanisms have been adopted by the agricultural holding, then the sustainability status is desirable. If at least one has been adopted or implemented, then the sustainability status is yellow. And finally, if there is no access to the above mitigation mechanism, the sustainability status is red or unsustainable. Okay. I'm gonna show you where to find the information. So we need to know about whether the agricultural holding accessed or availed credit or insurance. And this can be easily found here in question A8. Did this holding have access to or avail any of the following mechanism for protection against external shock. And here you have the list of options. And finally, we need to know about on-farm diversification. So this is the third variable that we need to construct. For this variable, again, we need the information on section two about the agricultural, the value of production from, section A, not section two, it's section A, about the value of production of the agricultural holding, plus we need specific information from the value of production of each crop to know whether livestock, whether there has been a diversification in agricultural activities. So we want that each agricultural commodity is, the value of each agricultural commodity is not greater, higher than 66% of total value of agricultural production. And here is where you have also the information on other on-farm products and the corresponding name. Okay, while the first two variables, which is access to or availed credit or insurance, are pretty straightforward, so they can be easily computed from the information based on the information from the survey, the third variable needs to be constructed by combining the value of production of each agricultural commodity in a given farm and the total value of production from the farm. So we want to know what's the share of each agricultural commodity over total value of production. Therefore, agricultural holding that diversify their on-farm production, of course, are those with a share of a single agricultural commodity, which is lower than 66% of the total value of production. Now, here is an example which is based on the data from the pilot survey. You see here you have the total value of production of a given agricultural holding, and you have the corresponding share from all the agricultural commodity. Of course, for reason of space, I had to include only few agricultural commodities. So I added crop one and crop five, but in reality, you can have and also livestock one. But in reality, you will have much more agricultural commodities that have been, the value of much more agricultural commodities that have been collected through the survey. Therefore, okay, this is an example based on, for example, holding number three and four. You see that the value from the first crop commodities is only 3.2% of total agricultural production. However, the value from the first livestock is 80.8%. So there is not really diversification of agricultural activities that seem to be concentrated around the given agricultural commodity, which is livestock number one. And the same applies to the fourth agricultural holding. So that's the rationale behind the risk mitigation mechanism sub-indicator. Now I move to the status script, which is the one for sub-indicator number three. And I'll show you the technical implementation. Again, I'm gonna upload the data set that we need, which are basically the data set from section A. I'm gonna compute the value of production from crop activities and the final value of production from the agricultural holding, the overall value of production. Then what I do here is a sort of loop where I calculate for each crop, so this is crop number one, crop number two, etc. This is the byproduct crop number 4, 3, etc. Let me zoom in so to make it more visible. Here you have livestock number 1, 2, etc. What I do is to generate a new variable which corresponds to the share of each crop over total value of production. And then I'm gonna, let's say, highlight this variable by constructing a dummy, which takes value 1 if the share of any of these commodities is greater than 66%. This is what I basically do using this loop here. And as you can see, if I run this portion of the data set, I will get, okay, you see here is the loop. I have 99 agricultural holding or 25% whose value of production is basically concentrated around a single agricultural commodity, which is the dummy variable that I constructed here. Then what I do is to generate three variables, one for each risk mitigation mechanism. And I say, okay, generate a dummy which is equal to 1 if the agricultural holding can access credit. Generate another dummy equal to 1 if the agricultural holding can access insurance. And finally, if the agricultural holding do not do diversify, I'm sorry, if the agricultural holding diversifies its own production. So each commodity is not greater than 66%. And then I generate a variable which is equal to the total number of risk mitigation mechanisms. This is the key variable that we have, which I'm gonna show you. Which is here, you see these are the number of risk mitigation mechanisms for each agricultural holding that you have. In this case, this agricultural holding has two risk mitigation mechanisms. And if I go back to my slide, and I see that adding at least two means that the sustainability status of the agricultural area is green or desirable. In this case, there is no risk mitigation mechanism, therefore is red. In this case, only one, therefore is yellow. I generate my sub indicator and I attach a label. And finally, as I did before, I'm gonna keep only the portion of the data set that I need for sub indicator number 3. If I look at the distribution, I can see that almost 60% of total agricultural holding adopted at least two risk mitigation mechanisms. Therefore, their sustainability status is desirable. Whereas we have more than 8% of total agricultural holding whose sustainability status is red, is unsustainable because they do not adopt any risk mitigation mechanism. Okay, Stefania, should we take a break or do we want to?
Yes, so let's wait a couple of seconds to see if participants have some. Okay, so welcome back. I hope you have had a nice break. You have refreshed your minds. Now, so we have seen with Gianluigi the first dimension, so the economic dimension with the three sub-indicators. And now we move to the next dimension, the environmental one, which has five sub-indicators. For sure, we will not finish today the environmental dimension, but it's not a problem. We will continue tomorrow. Actually, it was already in the plan. So Gianluigi, don't worry about timing. As Aspandia said, we can for sure also adjust the next 2 days. So I leave again the floor to you, and you have the floor.
Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So again, I'm gonna share my screen. We're now gonna focus on the first three sub-indicator related to the environmental dimension. So again, the process will be the same. We will first explore a little bit the way they have to be computed, and then we will look at some practical exercises using Stega. Let's see if we can finish this dimension by today. I don't think so, because there is a relatively long list of sub-indicators to be calculated. There are 5 sub-indicators in total, which I'm gonna list. These are the prevalence of soil degradation, variation in water availability, management of fertilizer, management of pesticide, and use of agrobiodiversity supportive practices. For sure, I will try to finish at least the first 3 sub-indicators, and then we will see if we can anticipate the remaining 2 sub-indicators so that we will have more time for discussion tomorrow. Even because I guess that a strong focus will be on the final dashboard approach to see how all these indicators will be combined together, and we will assess the sustainability status of agricultural holdings, of land areas associated to agricultural holdings. Okay, the first sub-indicators basically captures the proportion of agricultural areas according to the sustainability status on the basis of 4 soil health threats that the agricultural holding may experience over the past 3 years prior to the date of the interview. There are basically 4 threats that have been identified for the construction of this indicator. These are erosion, reduction in soil fertility, water logging, and salinization. And then there might be any other specific threats that can be reported by the respondent to the enumerator, which need to be, let's say, specifically assessed. The idea behind the assessment of the sustainability status of agricultural area is to look at whether the combined area affected by any or any combination of these threats is negligible. And when we say negligible, we means that less than 10% of the total agricultural area of the farm has been affected by any or more of these soil health threats. In case the percentage of the agricultural area affected by these threats is comprised between 10 and 50% of the total agricultural area of the farm, then the sustainability status will be acceptable. And finally, if the portion of the agricultural area affected is above 50%, the sustainability status of the agricultural area of the holding is gonna be red or unsustainable. Perhaps something that I forget to mention is that, of course, if the agricultural area has not been affected by any threats, the sustainability status will be by default desirable or green. Okay, what information do we need and where we can find the information to construct the sub-indicators? Basically, we need 3 main variables to be constructed. The first variable to be constructed is to know whether or not the holding was affected by any of the soil degradation threats. And of course, in case there is an affirmative response, then we want to know what's the proportion of the agricultural area that has been affected by these threats. So you will see here, and I'm going to zoom in again, that in question 2.2, section 2, question number 2, you will have the typical question concerning the total agricultural area of the holding, which is our numerator, and then the agricultural area that was affected by, potentially affected in reality, by these threats. Therefore, there is a sort of logical order. We will first ask whether the area of the agricultural area of the holding was affected by the threats that we listed before, soil erosion, reduction in soil fertility, water logging and salinization, and finally, none of the above, which implies that by default, the sustainability status is desirable. In case the respondent reported that one or more threats affected the agricultural area, then we will further ask what is the total area that has been affected. Again, in theory, in principle, the unit of measurement should be the same, both for the total agricultural area and for the agricultural area affected. But in case the respondent will report two different units of measurement, we need to standardize in order to calculate the share of the agricultural area affected. And the standardization process basically implies to apply a conversion factor to convert everything in hectares. So these are the key information that we need. And the sustainability status will be calculated accordingly. This is an example. The example basically illuminates about the calculation of the share of the agricultural area affected, which is given by the total area of in hectares affected by any threats and the total agricultural area of the holding. And this is reported, you see, in the third column of this table. You will see that this is the percentage affected, which must be multiplied by 100 in order to get the share. So for example, in the case of the first agricultural holding, whose total agricultural area is 0.9 hectares, what has been affected by one of the threats that we saw before is approximately 0.4 hectares. Therefore, the corresponding share is 44.8%. This implies that the sustainability status associated with the agricultural area of the first holding is going to be acceptable. Because if we go back to the sustainability criteria, we said before that in order to be acceptable is between 10% and 50% of the total agricultural area. Okay, I'm gonna focus like on a few agricultural holding that reported a proportion of area affected by one of those threats, which is higher than 50%. You see here from holding number 4 to holding number 8 that the percentage goes from a minimum of 57.9%. to a maximum of 75.2%. All these holdings, agricultural holdings, are unsustainable, and the reason is because the proportion of their effect is higher than 50%, which is the sustainability criteria for, or to better say, the unsustainability criteria for associated to this agricultural holding. So this is the rationale behind the computation of the indicator. And now, as usual, I'm going to move to the calculation of this indicator. So this is indicator number 4, as you can see here. The indicator number four need a few information which are related to the total area of the holding plus a few information that have been captured using section B, which is the economic section of the agricultural model. And we need to merge these two portions of the raw data set together in order to calculate our indicator, our sub-indicator. So again, the first thing to be done is to convert the total agricultural area into a standard unit of measurement, in which case is hectare. So what I'm gonna do is simply to apply a conversion factor in order to have everything in hectare. And then I need to also to know the land area that has been affected. And again, in order to harmonize this process, everything must be converted in hectares, which is our standard unit of measurement. So once I have computed the two primary variables, which are basically the total agricultural area and the agricultural area affected, I can calculate the share of the agricultural area that has been affected by one or any combination of the threats that we saw before. So I'm gonna compute the share. Here is the share affected. These are the summary statistics. You see on average 50% of the total agricultural area based on data from pilot survey have been affected from by any of the threats. But we wanna know specifically which are the agricultural holding affected. So what I'm gonna do is to say, okay, the sustainability status is desirable, whose code is one. In case, and I'm gonna show you the tabulation of this variable, the agricultural holding was not affected by any threats that we listed. So 43% of the total agricultural holding reported that none of the threats affected the agricultural area. So by default, they are desirable. But the sustainability status is still desirable in cases where the area affected that we calculated before here is lower than 10%. And let's be honest here, okay. And we have 58, you can see here, there are 58 agricultural holding who have been affected by any of the threats that we listed before, but the portion of their affected is lower than 10%. So they are still sustainable. In case the area affected is between 10%, is at least 10% or lower than 50%, the sustainability status is acceptable. And finally, we will have a sustainability status which is unsustainable in case the proportion of the area affected by any of those threats is higher than 50%. So I'm gonna compute these last two. Codify these last two sustainability status. I'm gonna touch a label again, and I'm gonna save this portion of the data set, which is related to the fourth sub-indicator that is now associated to the environmental dimension. I'm gonna save my data set in a specific folder, and you will see again that we have a very simple but immediate data set where for each household, for each holding, we know the corresponding sustainability status of the associated area related to this sub-indicator, of course, needless to say. Okay, I'm gonna close everything now, and I'm gonna move to the next sub-indicator,
let's see if we have question for this one.
Yeah, sure.
It seems not, so you can move on.
Okay. Okay, the fifth sub-indicator is related to variation in water availability. This sub-indicator, again, measure the share or the proportion of the agricultural area that is sustainable according to the sustainability status, which is defined according to three main, let's say, variables. These variables are whether the agricultural holding use water to irrigate their crops, and this must be on at least 10% of the agricultural area, if the agricultural holding experienced any reduction in water availability over time, and if there is an inefficient functioning of organizations that are in charge of water allocation. So we want to know whether, in case there is a reduction in water availability for any reason, we want to know if there is at least some organization that can basically, that has an efficient functioning to reduce this reduction in water availability. The sustainability status are defined accordingly, which is we will have a sustainability status desirable in case the water availability remains stable over the years. Of course, for those farmers that irrigate their crop on more than 10% of the agricultural area. The default is that the sustainability status is desirable if the irrigation process, let's say, occurs on less than 10% of the total agricultural area. So, just to better explain, the idea is that in case farmers are irrigating their land on more than 10% of the agricultural area, there are no reduction in water availability, which has remained stable over years. Therefore, we can classify that specific holding as sustainable. The same applies to farms that irrigate on less than 10% of the total agricultural area. Now, the sustainability status is acceptable in case agricultural holding uses water to irrigate their crops, again, on at least 10% of the agricultural area of the farm. They are not fully aware on whether there has been a reduction in water availability or water availability has remained stable over the year, or they know there is a reduction in water availability, but even if there is this reduction, there is an organization that effectively allocates water among users. In all other cases, which basically experiences reduction in water availability on more than 10% of the agricultural land, there is no organization that effectively allocates water. In that cases, the sustainability status of the agricultural holding is gonna be red or unsustainable. What information do we need in order to derive this sustainability status? Again, looking at the information collected through the survey module, we want to know whether or not the agricultural holding irrigates its land. By default, if there is no irrigation, then the sustainability status is green. We want to know what's the percentage of area of the agricultural holding that was used for irrigating crops. And here is the answer and the information collected through the survey. So basically, the respondent reports that he or she irrigates the agricultural land, and also the area in hectares or in whatever unit of measurement that is irrigated. And finally, we want to know, it's not really finally because there is one more variable. We want to know whether water remains stable over here. And again, the information can be collected using question before, which specifically asks whether the holder is observing a reduction in water availability from any source, which can be the lake, the canal, the river, etc. And finally, if in the area of interest there are organizations that effectively allocate water among users. This is all the information that we need in order to construct our sub-indicator and to derive the sustainability status. And this information, of course, need to be combined together. Now, we need a total of, so these are the raw variables that we need, and then we need to construct six primary variables to derive the sustainability status. I'm going to list each of these variables. The first variable is whether or not water was used for crop irrigation. This variable is basically a dummy variable, which takes value one in case the agricultural holding uses water for crop irrigation and zero otherwise. We want to know the total area irrigated, and this variable is a continuous variable expressed in hectares, which give basically the volume of area that is irrigated for a given agricultural holding. We need to construct an additional dummy variable, which takes on value one if the agricultural holding experienced a reduction in water availability, or if the holder observed any reduction in water availability, to better say. An additional dummy variable, which basically would inform us on whether there is an organization dealing with water allocation in the area where the holding is located. Of course, we need again the agricultural area of the holding, the total agricultural area of the holding, because we want to know the share that is irrigated. And in order to know the share that is irrigated, the percentage of total area irrigated, we simply need basically to divide the total agricultural area irrigated, which is our second primary variable, by the total agricultural area, which is our fifth primary variable, in order to get the percentage of area irrigated. Now, here I have reported an example which is based on real data from the pilot, where you have the sustainability status for three agricultural holding. One sustainability status is desirable. This applies to agricultural holding number one. And you can see here that the percentage of area that is irrigated is basically 90% of total agricultural area of the holding. However, variable B03, which is gonna inform us whether or not there was an irrigation process within the agricultural holding. And then we have an additional variable, which is B04, which tell us whether the water is progressively going down, if it is stable, and so on and so forth. We have a final variable, and this raw variable is variable B05, which tells us whether there are organizations and how these organizations are working. In the very first case, we have define the sustainability status of agricultural holding number one as desirable, because even if the total agricultural area irrigated is a bit less than 90% of the total agricultural area, the water is always available in sufficient quantity. So in this case, if we go back to our sustainability criteria, we say that the water availability remains stable over the years for those farms irrigating more than 10% of the agricultural area. And indeed, looking at the information associated to this agricultural holding, despite irrigating 90% of the total agricultural area, the water is available in sufficient quantity. There is no reduction in water availability. The second agricultural holding instead, it has a sustainability status which is acceptable. That's because the share of the agricultural area which is irrigated is higher than 10%, is 71%. In addition to that, that agricultural holding is reporting that the water level is progressively going down. So there is a reduction in water availability. However, despite this, there are organizations that are located around the area where the agricultural holding is that are working well and are allocating, distributing water among users in an efficient way. Again, just to clarify these sustainability criteria, I go back to the criteria for making the agricultural the sustainability status acceptable, which is uses water to irrigate crop on at least 10% of agricultural area of the farm. In the case of the second agricultural holding, we have approximately 71% that is irrigated. Does not know whether the water availability remains stable or there is a reduction, which is our specific case. There is a reduction of water availability, but there is an organization that allocates water efficiently among users. And these are exactly the, the information corresponding to the second agricultural holding. Last case is related to the agricultural holding number 36, which is not sustainable. The reason why is that the share of agricultural area irrigated is approximately 74%, so much higher than 10%. Water is progressively going down, and there are no organizations that are basically allocating water among users. Again, quickly going back in all other cases. In all other cases, it implies that we need to exclude the criteria that apply to sustainability status, which is desirable or acceptable. Okay, this was the second indicator. And now I'm gonna show you the calculation process for the second indicator related to the environmental dimension. In this case, again, this is a relatively short, but of course it depends on how the information has been collected, whether using the survey module or any other or information collected through other survey. I'm gonna upload the relevant data set that we need. And again, the process is to convert the total agricultural area, which is our one of our primary variables. Then we're gonna calculate the land area that is irrigated. And finally, we are gonna calculate the share, the proportion of area of the farm, which is experiencing a reduction in water availability, which is irrigated. I'm sorry. The final indicator that we calculate, which is this one, I'm gonna zoom in. This has a sustainable status, a desirable status, in case, and here we need to explore all the variables that we use, which are the primary variable that I showed you before, whether water was used or not. In this case, if the respondent said that water was not used, because either they do not need irrigation or there is not water available, in this case, by default, since the area is not irrigated, we can assign the green sustainability status to this agricultural area. Then we focus on those agricultural holdings that irrigate more than 10% of the total agricultural area. And you see here, I'm sorry, at most 10% of total agricultural area. Water for irrigation is at most 10% of the total agricultural area, which is if the area irrigated is at most 10%, again, the sustainability status is gonna be green. And finally, we're gonna assign a sustainability status which is green to all agricultural holding who self-reported that they do not experience any reduction in water availability. And this information is captured by this variable here. No, water is always available in sufficient quantity. And again, I'm gonna construct this sub-indicator number 5. Now we move to agricultural holding whose sustainability status is acceptable. In order to be acceptable, the area irrigated must be greater than 10%, as we saw before. And at the same time, they do not know whether there is a reduction in water availability. You may recall, looking at the information here, they use water to irrigate crops on at least 10% of the agricultural area, but they do not know whether the water remains stable over the year. So this is the first two criteria in order to be acceptable. I'm gonna compute this value. You will see that there are no agricultural holding. There are no changes made to the final sub-indicator. The other cases instances where the water availability is reducing. So there is a reduction in water availability, but there are also organizations that are effectively allocating water among users. And this is the key variable that we need here. So the question asked is whether there are organizations dealing with water allocation, and all agricultural holding saying yes, and they are working well. In this case, despite a reduction in water availability, we're gonna consider them. We're gonna define the sustainability status as accepted. In all other cases, as we saw before, the sustainability status is gonna be red or unsustainable. So again, I'm gonna rerun the entire script. I'm gonna attach the label to the fifth sub-indicator, and I'm gonna save this additional portion of the dataset. And if you take a closer look at the data, the structure is exactly the same as for the other sub-indicator, where you have the agricultural holding unique code and the corresponding sustainability status associated with sub-indicator number 5. Okay, so I move to, I go, yeah, I now move to the sixth sub-indicator related to the environmental dimension. And the sixth sub-indicator basically capture agricultural area according to their sustainability status, which is defined based on how fertilizer are managed by the agricultural holding itself. Okay, the information that we need in order to compute this primary variable is whether the agricultural holding uses or not the fertilizer. And this information can be easily collected through question number B6. Did this agricultural holding use any synthetic or mineral fertilizer? I want to know in case the fertilizer are used, the number of specific measures adopted to mitigate, of course, the environmental risks that are associated with the use of fertilizer. And here you see that the two information that we need. Okay, so the logical order is that first, we're gonna collect information on whether or not fertilizer are used. Second, in case fertilizer are used, we wanna know whether the agricultural holding took a specific measure to mitigate the environmental risk associated with the use of synthetic fertilizer. In case they say yes, in this case, we are gonna ask to the respondent what are the specific environmental measure adopted by the agricultural holding in order to, you know, to reduce the risk associated with the use of synthetic and mineral fertilizer. There are a number of measures that can be adopted. I'm not gonna list all of them, but just whether they use, they follow protocol as per extension services, whether they use organic source of nutrients, and so on and so forth. These are all the measures that have been considered to reduce environmental risk associated with fertilizer. Okay, these are the variables that we need to compute. This is the content of the primary variable. Now, the content of the primary variable, these are basically all dummy variables. The first one, which is the key primary variable, is whether or not the fertilizer was used. In case the agricultural holding does not use any fertilizer, then the sustainability status is desirable by default. The additional dummy variable that we need to compute are basically eight dummy variables, taking value one if the specific measure was adopted by the agricultural holding. So just to give you an example, if the agricultural holding follows protocol as per extension services, then we're gonna compute a dummy variable which is equal to one and zero otherwise. And the same applies to all other dummy variables related to measure adopted to reduce the environmental risk of fertilizer. Finally, we will compute the only categorical variable, which goes from 0 to 8, and which basically captures the total number of measures taken by the holding in order to mitigate the environmental risk, which is this one. You see, this is this variable is basically the summation of all the measures adopted by the agricultural holding. Okay, here is an example that is being extracted by the data set. of four agricultural holding. All of them use fertilizer for their agricultural production related activities. But the number of measures adopted in order to reduce the risk associated with fertilizer varies depending on the agricultural holding. In the case of the first agricultural holding, the sustainability status is acceptable because the number of measures adopted is two. So if the number of measure adopted is at least two, but lower than four, the sustainability status is acceptable. If the number of measure adopted is lower than two, so either zero or one, and the agricultural holding uses fertilizer, then the sustainability status is red. And this is the case of the second agricultural holding. You see here that the agricultural holding uses fertilizer, but no measures have been adopted to mitigate the environmental risk of fertilizer. And even in instances where the number of measures adopted would be one, the sustainability status would still be red, because in order to be acceptable, at least two measures must be adopted. Finally, and this is the case of agricultural holding number 13 and 14, the sustainability status here is desirable because despite using fertilizer, both agricultural holdings, they adopt at least four measures to reduce the environmental risk of fertilizer. So the real difference in order to define a given sustainability status, given the large utilization of fertilizer, is really given by the measures that have been adopted by the holding in order to reduce the environmental risk of fertilizer. Okay, I'm now gonna show you the calculation of this sixth indicator. And again, here I summarized for ease of reference the number of the sustainability criteria. Green does not use fertilizer, but or uses fertilizer, but takes a specific measure to mitigate environmental risk, which must be at least four. Yellow, if the holding uses fertilizer at least, and but takes at least two measures to mitigate environmental risk. And red, in case the number of measures adopted by the holding is lower than two. Okay, I'm gonna upload the portion of the data set. Okay, these are all the measures that have been collected from the survey. For example, just to give you an example, if you search the first measure is follow protocol as per extension services, which is basically, let me go back here, which is basically what you will find in, I'm sorry, in question B9, follow protocol as per extension services. We simply converted this information into a dummy variable, which takes value one if the measure has been adopted, and zero otherwise. You will see from the distribution that 160 agricultural holding adopted follow protocol as per extension services or retail outlet recommendation. And the same applied to the remaining measures that are listed in the survey model. So what I'm gonna do is to simply generate a loop and to calculate a dummy which is equal to zero if the specific measure was not adopted and one otherwise. and I'm gonna generate the total number of agricultural measures adopted. I tabulate this variable. You see that there are approximately 197 agricultural holding corresponding to 46% of total agricultural holding sampled that did not adopt any measure, even if we don't really know whether they simply did not adopt measure because fertilizer were not used. And then we have like 13 and 12% of agricultural holding that adopted at most two measures and so on and so forth. So only less than 1% of total agricultural holding or three agricultural holding adopted six measures to mitigate environmental risk of fertilizer. Okay, I'm gonna calculate this indicator as per the criteria that are listed here. So I say the sustainability status is gonna be green if the fertilizer was not used. This is the variable that captures whether or not the fertilizer was used. And there are 21 agricultural holding you see here that did not use any fertilizer. Then if the fertilizer was used, which is this variable here, variable B06, but the number of measures is greater than 4, the sustainability status is still green or desirable. If the fertilizer were used, but the number of agricultural measures is greater than 2, but lower than 4, then the sustainability status is going to be acceptable. And finally, if the number of agricultural measures adopted by the holding is lower than 2, and the holding uses fertilizer, then the sustainability status is going to be red. So I'm going to rerun the script. You see, this is very much straightforward. I'm going to keep my portion of the data set and I'm going to save it. Again, I know this is redundant, but again, here we will have for each agricultural holding, we will have the corresponding sustainability status given adoption or not of measure to mitigate environmental risk of fertilizer for holdings that use fertilizer, of course. Okay, this was in reality the last indicator that I wanted to present today. Now, my question is whether we want to keep going. I think we still have 15 minutes. I don't know if Asfandiar want to spend a few minutes for further recommendation or if you want to move ahead with the other sub-indicators.
So, yes, let's see first if we have some questions, Gianluigi, and then we leave the floor to Asfandiar. So we have time to close, let's say. We will take the conversation from here, of course, tomorrow, in case anyone else would like to ask something else to Gianluigi or to Asfandiar. Let's, if you all agree, let's switch on our video so I can take a proper picture because yesterday, you know, we have had some issues. So I ask all of you to switch on the video. I mean, the ones that, of course, would like to be visible in the picture.
Oh, it says that, you know, I cannot open this video because probably... Probably you stopped all of us to open the video.
Really?
Yeah. It is not allowing us.
Yes.
Let me see why.
It takes time, you know, like yesterday, we can, you know, think of this conversation tomorrow.
We are... Wait. Allow panelists to start. Okay. Now you should... Okay, great.
yeah, it is coming.
Okay.
You know, Zoom sometimes has some these hidden features, and sometimes they switch on or off by themselves. Okay, so we still have a few people with no video. Let's wait a few seconds if they want. If not, I will take the picture like this. It's very nice to see all of you. Okay, so let me take the picture now. 1, 2, 3. Okay. I think I did it. Yes. Okay. Okay, so thanks again for having participated to this third day. Second day, sorry. Second day of the virtual training. So we still have 2 days. And have a nice day and see you tomorrow, same time. So 2 p.m. Bangladesh time.
And before you close, do you remember I requested one thing for Friday? You know, there's, Friday is our weekly
yes.
prayer day. So if you delay half an hour, it will be fine.
Yes, that was, So on Friday, we will start half an hour later, but tomorrow we start still.
Tomorrow we'll start at 30.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. Yeah, no problem. Okay, bye-bye.
Okay, bye. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Kamrul Sahib, it is open 3.1, it is open. Nomination.